for the hardest hitting show in talk radio. The true progressive voice since 2012. This is Southpaws.
And welcome to Southpaws on the Pacifica Radio Network. We are the leaders of the revolution. My name is Darren Gibson, and I am your co-host.
And I'm Jack Prince, your sock jock. Your shock jock. Your sock for my jock.
Yeah. Oh, geez. Will you stop that? What was it Rick Becky used to say? Shock jock. Filth merchant. God, we miss Rick Beckett in this town, I tell you. Well, we've got quite a few topics to discuss. First of all, Katy is off today. An emergency kind of came up, so she's hopefully going to rejoin us next week. Boy, we've got a lot. Mm-hmm. We got to talk about Kyle Rittenhouse. We got to talk about profanity. Not yours, somebody else's. We have a Hammer Time segment right out of Congress and plenty more. So, folks, before we get started, a couple of reminders that you can follow us on social media by going to facebook.com/Southpaws Radio Show. Follow us on Twitter at Southpaws Radio. You can follow us on Tumblr at southpawsradioshow.tumblr.com. You can follow us on YouTube by doing a search for Southpaws Radio. You can become a patron of the show by going to patreon.com/Southpaws Radio. You can listen to the show anytime you like at Spreaker, Stitcher, Apple Podcasts, or Reason.fm by doing a search for Southpaws. Once you found our logo, you found us. We send our episodes weekly to our Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, and YouTube accounts. You can listen to us on Global Community Radio Channel 1 every Saturday night at 11 Eastern. And you can listen to us on Great Pacifica stations, including KCEI in Taos, New Mexico, KZGM in Kabul, Missouri, and KEPJ in San Antonio, Texas. So make sure you listen to us there as well.
Yeah, and listen, Darren,
go ahead.
Months ahead now, when you're looking for the greatest 20 shows of Southpaw's history, I'm going to make it easy. This is going to
this
be one
is
of them.
This is definitely going to be one of them.
This has the asterisk right on top. Just pick it up. It's going to be ready to go.
And by the way, we are recording this show on Friday, November 12th, 2021, and we're going to start off with a little bit of music. I have a question for everybody. Why is it that military people love ABBA so much? I honestly want an answer to that question. I really do. I love ABBA because, just listen. The hair standing up on my arms right now. Agneta and Frida have the most beautiful harmonies ever in the history of pop music, in the history of disco, whatever you want to call it. I mean, they're considered a pop act. Hell, they were popular in the 70s during the disco era, so I consider them a disco act. But I love them just because of their music that they play. What is it?
It's got to be the content.
Military people. John McCain, favorite band, ABBA. G. Gordon Liddy, about once a week when he was doing his radio show, he would come back from one of his breaks and start playing Dancing Queen. Colin Powell, at his funeral last week, had the brass band from the Marines playing Dancing Queen because that was his favorite song.
ABBA, you mean the Colin Powell with a bloody legacy?
Absolutely.
The militaristic legacy. He likes ABBA. I'm trying to make a connection there.
I'm trying to make a connection, too, and it doesn't make any sense. ABBA never sung one single song about war. They've always been happy songs like this, or you kind of get the opposite side with songs like The Winner Takes It All or Knowing Me, Knowing You, which is another one of my all-time favorites.
Of course, now, yesterday was Veterans Day. Did that have something to do with your curiosity?
No, this is no. Just watching Colin Powell's funeral and the recognition the commentators, I think it was the CBS commentators, were like, if that music sounds familiar, it's ABBA. It's Dancing Queen from ABBA.
Well, my favorite veteran tribute yesterday was to those great military leaders that fought against colonialism here. Cochise, Geronimo, Black Jack,
yeah.
Bigfoot, Crazy Horse. Here's a picture of all the real warriors on Veterans Day. I bet that boiled the racist blood across the United States if they saw that. But I don't know about the ABBA.
Yeah, I don't get it.
It's got to be a mood that's
don't
established.
Get it. Because they never sung about war, like I said. They're about peace and love.
You think Guns N' Roses or, I don't know, something with some...
Oh, just speed metal bands.
Yeah.
You'd figure it'd be some hard rock, you know. Ronald Reagan loved to come out to Born in the USA, even though it was an anti-Vietnam song. You know, I mean, what the hell?
It's an interesting question.
These warmongers are just absolutely... I hate to use the phrase tone deaf, but I guess it works in this case. No, seriously. Hey. If somebody can answer that question for me, send me an email at southpawsradio@yahoo.com because I would love to know what the answer is. Or message us on our Facebook page or hit us up on Twitter.
It's the kind of group, in my estimation, which means nothing musically, okay?
Yeah.
That sets a mood,
mm-hmm.
just their flow and their sound. Like, to me, the Bee Gees do the same
yes.
thing. And I would think the Bee Gees would be as ridiculous for a military favor or appetite
yeah.
as ABBA.
Yeah. And we do have to mention this, just since we're talking about ABBA. I just picked up Voyage, their new and their final studio album. They're never recording again. These women, Agneta and Frida, went back into the studio, and they have not lost a single step.
Wow.
The harmonies are just beyond beautiful.
And they're related. They're
tears.
Sisters, right?
No, they're not.
They're not related?
No, not at all.
That's unusual.
No. Frida was married to Benny in the band, and Agneta was married to Bjorn, but they've all have broken up since.
Huh.
And Benny and Bjorn have been producing music ever since. It's just... You know, here's the thing, and here's the other thing, and I want to mention this too, since we're talking about ABBA and some of these military people, the violent people. You know, ABBA a few years ago was offered $1 billion to reunite and tour, and they turned it down.
Huh.
I saw an interview on YouTube, I forget what channel, might have been CBS. I think it was 60 Minutes. No, I think it was the Sunday morning program, Jane Pauley. And Bjorn's talking about, hey, we've turned down emirs from Saudi Arabia. One of our listeners messaged me and said that he believes that Putin asked them to perform and they turned him down too.
Huh. They're just not going to do it.
Yeah, no. They're
you got to think for $1 billion.
No. Benny and Bjorn are fine with touring. They don't care. It's Frida and Agneta that do not want to tour anymore. They're happy
really?
With their lives. They're happy with what they're doing. But one thing I want to do, I'm really giving serious consideration to getting my passport so that I can travel to London in May of next year because they're going to have the Avatars. It's an ABBA concert in London, but it's not going to be the actual... members of ABBA,
right.
It's Avatars.
Huh.
They've gone through and had the 3D hologram stuff done already. And
it's entertaining, but don't take it to court.
Yeah.
Don't take a video from the streets of Kenosha
with
enlargement because it could be violated. It could have been transformed by adding pixels.
Jesus.
Let's go down that street when we
let's go down that right now. So yeah, I'm like I said, I picked up ABBA Voyage. I usually don't hawk records on this show. That's not what this show is about, but I will this time. Pick up ABBA Voyage, listen to all of it. It is beautiful. And it's the number one song on Apple iTunes right now.
Yeah. Speaking of a song, there's no singing coming out of little Rittenhouse, except sobs with no tears. He reminds me of the old Johnny Rivers song, the Tracks of My Tears. But there's no tracks. There's no tears. And the thing is, there now, this has become really a Saturday Night Live skit.
Except it's not funny.
Except it's not funny, and you have murdered people and a guy with his arm blown off that will be given absolutely no justice. But you got a guy complaining about the Asian food holdup. You've got a so-called legal expert who will not allow information showing Rittenhouse a day after the shooting with a shirt on, bragging about not being incarcerated with the Proud Boys. You've got a guy that, a judge, I don't even know if guy is disrespectful enough. I can't think of anything else. Who will not allow video, actual video, to be played in the courtroom because of the possibility it's lost its authenticity because of an enlargement. No different than when you have a picture on your phone, Darren, and you want to see a little better, and you enlarge it. Mm-hmm. It does not change the content of the picture. It's a cavalcade of absolute racist, conservative judgments coming from the bench. It is beyond a movie. This is, forget the guy down south in Mississippi with the New York couple. Remember the guy in the Munsters? Remember he played the judge with DeVito, my cousin Vinny? You know the case I'm talking about, the little cracker courtroom down in Mississippi. This is beyond anything I've seen in my life, except that it's being paralleled down south in Georgia. And I'm not even going to get into the Aubrey case, except to say that the attorney there will not allow any black people, particularly black ministers, to sit in the audience.
Yeah, here's the story you're talking about, the Asian food. This is Nicole Chavez writing for CNN. This is dated November 11th. The judge presiding over the homicide trial of Kyle Rittenhouse confused observers after making a strange and off-color joke inside the courtroom on Thursday. Kenosha County Circuit Court Judge Bruce Schroeder, as the court was preparing to take a lunch break, said, quote, "I hope the Asian food isn't on one of those boats from Long Beach Harbor," end of quote. Schroeder, the longest-serving active judge in Wisconsin's trial courts, appeared to be referring to the supply chain backlogs caused by congestion problems in California ports. But his comments were offensive and perceived as anti-Asian by some and as placing blame on Asian people for a large-scale event. John Yang, president and executive director of the Asian Americans Advancing Justice, said, quote, "It harms our community and puts us in the crosshairs of microaggressions as well as actual physical violence," end of quote. Yang said it is clear the judge does not have cultural sensitivity. Gee, could have surprised me with that.
You think so?
Yeah. His remarks were meant to denigrate or minimize Asian Americans and, quote, "any Asian American that sees or hears the statement will understand that he is making fun of or mocking our community. This is a great illustration of how Asian Americans are not immune from racial bias and discrimination in our criminal justice system," end of quote.
Folks, we have, in the United States, thanks to Trump, millions of minds of racism that need one little drop to trip them into action. One little straw to tip over the entire structure of American accepted and conventional racism. And you take a comment like that, you may think that's innocuous. You may think that Trump's comments saying in Charlottesville that there's good people on both sides. I could spend the rest of the show talking about Trump's comments. Mm-hmm. But because of the precarious mindset in the streets, in the pickup trucks, behind the Confederate flags, in the evangelical churches, behind the QAnon followers, you spit out one little dog whistle, and it ends up in cracked heads, burnt homes. It ends up in the episode with a woman who was the gymnast being attacked because she just happens to be Asian as well.
And I'll get into that in
just
a second.
And I am really sick and tired. I am beyond sick and tired of people who give a pass to Trump. I'm going to say it plain as can be. When you put wind under Trump's wings for his racist comments and say nothing and do nothing and turn your head away, or even more egregiously, accept it, you're hurting people. It will result in deaths. How many, watch CNN at the tapes of Asian people that were punched in the face, old women punched in subways. How many people threatened in their homes and their children because of Donald J. Trump's racism?
Yep.
You can be politically completely ambivalent, and you can be libertarian. You can be whatever the hell you want, but don't turn your attention away from Trump's racism because it hurts innocent people.
Absolutely, it does. And it's not, it's his racism, it's his sexism, it's his mocking of people with physical disabilities. It's everything about him. It really is.
It is.
And we've talked about it on this show since 2015, 2016. We're starting to sound like a broken record, but we need to be, because there's people that forget about it. I've said it before, Americans have a short-term memory span. One thing happens, something else will happen, they forget about the first thing. A third thing will happen, they'll forget about the second thing and the first thing.
You heard them say verbatim, these pinheads, these pinhead conservatives saying, we're just waiting for the orders from Trump. We're just waiting. Do you remember hearing that? And you saw the results on January 6th. And the orders don't come with ABC. First of all, he doesn't even speak coherently to call it ABC. They're little dog whistles. Mm-hmm. They're little jabs. They're little innuendos. But you got to be totally blind and stupid to miss his racism. And you've got to be totally neglectful and an abject bully if you're not worried about the results of his racism.
Jack, I just saw my first blacked out American flag this week. You've heard about that.
I've heard about it. I haven't seen one yet.
I saw one, and I got news for you. If this starts to happen, if you think I'm going to cower, you better think again. You violent, evil conservatives.
You see the skulls now. You see the insignias of racist. You know, skull. Any type of skull.
Yeah, these 3% are holes.
Yeah. It's too bad that COVID doesn't kill four-wheel drive pickup trucks. Because guys hitchhiking all over. You see rednecks hitchhiking.
It needs to wipe their drivers out. But I'll say it. I don't care. Throw me off the air. I don't give a f***. Not today, I don't.
I am totally fed up. These bullies, these racist bullies tout these flags for intimidation.
Yeah. That's all it is.
They drag their big guns around like a little Rittenhouse when he was 9 years old, because it gives them a macho physical appearance. It gives them a gravitas they've never earned by their own merit in any way. You might as well strap it like a dildo around their waist, because that's all it is. It is a symbol of intimidation. It is a symbol of violence. And they're all in the same genre.
And I was just going to say that the gun is used as a substitute for their inadequate genitalia. So there you go.
But they have been unleashed by Donald J. Trump. And the red meat you put in front of that dog's nose before he goes and fights, and you let him out of his cage, is racism.
Yeah,
it's race. It's not neoliberalism. He's not trying to explain how they can become millionaires. He's not trying to tell them that there's an evil, corrupt cabal of Democrats. He uses racism. That's his number one aphrodisiac for these idiots.
Mm-hmm. It certainly is.
And anybody that disagrees with that, you're in the same boat. If you're missing that, and you don't, and you see these black flags drive by, or you're standing at a restaurant and a guy with a gun in his holster sitting there, and he's got his Trump sticker on, or worse, if you're blind to that and you say nothing, your relatives, you do nothing about it, you are perpetuating it. I am that totally set up.
You are part of the problem. You are not part of the solution. You are part of the problem because you are, what's the phrase? Complacency is complicity.
Yeah.
And it really is in this case. And I'll throw one more at you, folks. And I'm going to leave you with this. We're going to move on to something else here. We'll continue with the Asian hate stuff. I'm one of the biggest advocates. I am a firm believer of Karl Popper's paradox of tolerance. When you tolerate the intolerant take over. You need to squash the intolerant.
Let's say that again. When you tolerate the intolerant. See, that's the thing. When you have racists with torches walking through the streets, how many years ago now?
Not that long ago. Not
all
this-
Trump had to do was tolerate them. How did he tolerate them? In about a six-word sentence that says there's good people on both sides. That's no different than when the tobacco lobbyists came out, thanks to the corporate money, and said, well, you know, there's two sides to this. There are not two sides to racism. There are not two sides to being pregnant or not pregnant. You, when you give them that allowance to tolerate them, to even say, yeah, they've got a right for their opinion. No, they don't.
No, they don't. I've said that on the show. You do not have – sorry, you don't have a right to your wrong opinion.
Racism
if it's not
is
based
not
in facts.
Free speech. And now, what is the overwhelming political issue on the table today? Here's a quiz. Out to America. What do you think it is? The number one issue, I'm going to say it. I've got proof from other people who've said it smarter than me. It is CRT.
Critical race
the
theory.
The battle has gone into the classroom. And why has the battle gone into the classroom? Because the cement wall of racism that runs right through the middle of this country is not going to tolerate anybody knocking at the door. They're not going to budge an inch. They will not even listen to historical truth, to dates that have been completely substantiated. That's how bad this country is right now with racism, that they're not allowing the Civil War to be even taught. And you want to know how we got there? It's because of people that put their hands in their pocket and turns their head away from the blatant racism in this. Our history in the United States, it's racism. That's our history. It's not part of our history. It is our history. We came here with people to kill the Native Americans. That's racism. We put them in schools and buried them in the backyard after we raped them. That's racism. We then went to get people that wouldn't die from the heat to work our cotton fields and our tobacco fields, which killed millions of people, from a continent. We did it for 400 years. Our history is racism. That's the whole potential of our future, therefore, is racism. And you get a racist in the presidency, you better do something about it, damn it.
Yeah, absolutely.
We got to move on. My blood's getting hotter.
I've had friends of mine. I've had counselors that have said,
"You'd be surprised how many friends of mine are blind." But go ahead.
I've had friends and counselors that have said, "Darren, you think too much in black and white." No, because here's the pure and simple truth: there is truth, and then there is bullshit. Anything that is not truth is bullshit. Period. End of story.
And if your opinion and your perspective is a dangerous and damaging perspective, and it's not true, it's bullshit.
I think this show
that we're standing here, there hasn't been a day in the years that we've talked to Darren that's any more focused in our eyes, that burns our stomach right now than what we're talking about. Yeah. We've gone through some horrendous issues. I see this poor woman that's beaten with a lead pipe. They waited for her. And that's just today's act of racism.
Let's go on to this one then. You mentioned that Olympian. I've got another one here. This is Sophie Reardon writing for CBS News, dated November 11th. Olympic gymnast Suni Lee said this week that she was the target of a racist attack months ago after winning the gold at the Tokyo Olympics. Lee, a Hmong American, 18-year-old from Minnesota, told Pop Sugar's website about the alleged incident in an interview published Wednesday. Lee said the attack happened while she and her friends, all of whom are of Asian descent, were waiting out for an Uber after a night out. A car sped past them. The people in the car yelled racist slurs at them. One person sprayed Lee's arm with pepper spray. Lee told Pop Sugar, quote, "I was so mad, but there was nothing I could do or control because they skirted off. I didn't do anything to them, and having the reputation, it's so hard because I didn't want to do anything that could get me in trouble. I just let it happen." End of quote. She needs to not worry about getting herself in trouble. These people, I can't even call them people, these sacks of flesh need to be the ones that get in trouble. You racist, sexist morons. Let me continue here. Lee said she called Jess Graba, her longtime gymnast trainer and owner of Midwest Gymnastics, after the incident. He flew out to Los Angeles to be with her. Anti-Asian hate crimes have been on the rise since the start of the coronavirus pandemic. You can thank Trump for that one, too. with his Wuhan flu crap. In August, a report published by the nonprofit coalition Stop AAPI Hate found 9,081 anti-Asian incidents had been reported since the beginning of the pandemic in 2020. In 2021, physical assaults against Asian people in the U.S. increased from 10.8% of all incidents in 2020 to 16.6% this year. A majority of the incidents documented in the report took place in public. This is just disgusting. This is how we treat other people.
Yeah.
I'm not even going to say gymnast because it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what she does. It doesn't matter her celebrity. God, just please treat people like they're people.
Listen, it's across the board, too. You mentioned handicapped people. We saw Trump ridiculing a handicapped person. It should have been the end of the election right then and there. But that kind of personal racism. I can remember explicitly, within months after Trump was in office, the rates of bullies, bullyism, I guess, across America's public schools, across secondary education, skyrocketed. It skyrocketed. It wasn't COVID. It wasn't dietary. It wasn't a rock band. It was not a movie with an explicit pull towards being a bully. It was Donald J. Trump. His influence meant kids were getting beaten up in the playground, meant that they were being attacked in the bus, meant that they were being attacked online, meant that they were being attacked in front of their peers in class because of Donald J. Trump. And if you didn't stand against it, you were opening the door for the marches in Charlottesville. You were opening the door for the Asians that were beaten up. This was months later. But you should have picked up the tea leaf and said, kids getting bullied in school? And you can connect the dot with you got a brain cell that's on fire to Trump?
Yeah.
Could you have sat down and wondered where it would get us? Because look where it got us. Look where it got us. We had a mutual friend, Darren. I'm not going to say his name. I say a friend, I say he supported this show.
Mm-hmm.
He was a guy that came and supported when they were trying to railroad you out for taking a stand against the neoliberalism in the Democratic Party.
Yes.
Okay. I think we both know who we're talking about.
Yes, we do.
He was gracious. I mean, he was always supportive with his words and so forth. It's not like we were bosom buddies, either you or me, with him. But when he got to the point where it was clear he supported Donald Trump, that was it.
Yep.
Am I making that up in any way?
No, you're not.
That was it. No more correspondence with him. No more invitation on the show. No more nothing. No more anything.
No. Nope.
Nothing. If he put something on Facebook, we didn't respond.
No. Nope.
We're not going around saying we have hatred and the guy should be killed like conservatives do.
Yeah.
But that was the litmus test. That's the line that you don't cross.
Exactly.
You do not cross that line. A, you're a Trump supporter. B, you are neglectful to identify his racism. When
exactly.
they get to that point and they support them, you have nothing to do with them. If you have something to do with them, you are enabling them.
Exactly.
And yes. It results in a broken face. It results in a house being burnt down. It results in a poor woman being beaten with a pipe. That's the fruit of your unwillingness to admit it.
Two things I want to say, and then we need to go on to our next topic here. The first thing I want to say is, regardless of the viewpoints that we all have, and Jack, you have different viewpoints on some things. Katy has different viewpoints from both of us. Robust conversation is good. But at the end of the day, this show, Southpaws, is 100% mine. I own this show. I control the content. I will never, ever have a conservative guest on this show, ever. They already have enough outlets to spew their hate. They don't need any more. They don't deserve any more. And I mentioned the second thing. I said you need to squash intolerance. You want to know how you do it? When one of your friends says something that's racist, sexist, you call them out immediately. You don't let it go. If they don't want to correct their behavior, stop being friends with them. These people need to be shunned.
Yeah, you know what's going to happen if you don't? It's going to come for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
I have in my hand, I'm going to take the time to read it, a teacher that was found dead in Mexico. Teachers now, they're in the crosshairs.
Yeah.
They're hated because of Trump's racism.
Yeah.
Liberals, my goodness, they're the scourge. You've got anybody that is the least bit handicapped, they're not protected. Gays, homosexuals, blacks, that kind of racism knows no boundaries. And it's going to come for you. When you did nothing about his racism, it's a step closer to your door.
Absolutely. And if you think the cops are going to come and help you, that's not going to happen either. And let's get into that story, Jack. This is Wood Television out of Kalamazoo, Michigan. They've kind of buried the lead here, but we'll get to it. This is dated November 11th. A suspect who died after an hours-long standoff in Kalamazoo killed himself after repeatedly shooting at officers, police say. 35-year-old Alex Rawls of Kalamazoo was wanted for a November 1st shooting that injured his ex-girlfriend's sister, according to the Kalamazoo Department of Public Safety. Police say that Rawls shot her five times and then fired 17 shots into a nearby home. He also allegedly later threatened to again shoot the victim, her family, and police. A warrant for his arrest, including for attempted murder, was issued on November 3rd. Police say that they had learned on Monday, November 8th, that Rawls had been staying at a home on Washington Avenue near Division Street. They went there to arrest him, and he barricaded himself in the house. It started at 10:45 a.m. after the cops called for him over a loudspeaker to get out, and he wouldn't. KDPS says negotiators tried to get Rawls to give himself up, including getting family to urge him to surrender. At about 12 noon, Rawls fired several shots at officers. KDPS described his weapon as an assault rifle. Now, whether they're telling the truth, who knows? Throughout the afternoon and early evening, officers deployed non-lethal agents in the house in an attempt to get him to come out. At 10 after 6, officers started opening the doors and windows of the house. 25 minutes later, he started firing at cops again. Here's where the story is. This isn't what they're talking about. This should be the lead. Police then started tearing down the walls of the house, a tactic that Kalamazoo Department of Public Safety Chief Vernon Coakley said during a Thursday press conference is meant to allow officers to get eyes on the suspect. He said SWAT removed first floor support structures, creating an opening to the second floor where Rawls was. At about 9:40 p.m., police say that Rawls started shooting again. They continued to try to negotiate with him, used more non-lethal agents, and they tore more of the house down. This continued for five more hours. Total of a 16-hour standoff. They used 50 sets of chemical agents.
To explain chemical agents.
Tear gas.
Okay.
Which, by the way, is illegal to use in war. It's part of the Geneva Convention. Mm-hmm. But you can use it to break up protests.
Yeah.
At 2:53 a.m., the Kalamazoo Department of Public Safety said that Rawls fired more shots at officers and at an armored truck. Officers returned fire 3 minutes later. Rawls was hit, but apparently not fatally.
Okay, hold on. You mean to tell me you see fire? You've got trained rifles on the house.
Yeah, they returned fire after the, yeah.
How can you not hit him with 30 rifles repeating at an area this, you know, it's ridiculous. You'd still have a house. He might be dead. Nobody's going to argue maybe that he should be shot at. The question is, why destroy a family's home? Am I right?
Exactly.
How the hell could you not hit him with that kind of armament?
I'll get to that. So he was hit, but apparently not fatally. Officers saw Rawls turn the gun on himself. They entered the home, what was left of it, at around 3 a.m., and they found him dead. No officers were shot over the course of the standoff, but a sheriff's deputy was injured when a gunshot hit a window and he was hit by shattering glass. Whoopee. The KDPS officer and deputy who fired shots in the standoff are on paid leave while Michigan State Police investigate the use of force, which apparently is standard procedure.
And I wonder what their verdict will be.
Now, here's the important part. This is the part that we're beyond angry about. Landlord Gary Apps, who owned the house, and a neighbor told News 8 on Wednesday that Rawls did not live at the home. But according to investigators, the woman who lived there told them that Rawls, who was a friend of her boyfriend's, had been sleeping on the couch since November 2nd, the day after the shooting. Apps told News 8 he was never alerted that the house was going to be torn down. He said he discovered it when he saw it on the 11 o'clock news that part of the house had been pushed in. He said, quote, "I thought it was a little severe, but I wasn't there and it wasn't my call. It wouldn't have made a difference, but they still didn't check with me," end of quote. At his press conference, Chief Coakley said the damage to the first floor supports meant the house was unsafe and had to be torn down entirely. He said every decision was made with the intent of protecting lives. And when I heard that quote, the first word out of my mouth was bullshit. You want to know why? Because they don't care about lives. They care about protecting property. We've mentioned that on this show forever. We need to modify it now. They care about protecting rich people's property. The rest of us slobs can go sleep in the streets. Oh, wait, we can't even do that anymore.
Well, they notoriously have been on the side of corporations and big money. That's who they go, that's who they protect. Protester against Wall Street, they attack. They're not going to back away from their help of rich corporate owners. But the question I have, though, is tactically, what's the precedence here? This isn't the first guy holed up in a house with a gun. I've never seen a bulldozed house with a guy who's, you know, standing with a gun in a window defying the police. Historically, can you give me background, any precedence? I've never heard of this.
I've never heard of it either. I'm not saying it didn't happen, but
I've never
heard of it.
But is this a new tactic? Is this a new, we can just tear a house down? How about a neighborhood?
Katie and I talked about it on the phone last night, and she thought that she'd heard on the news that apparently this is a new tactic, that they're planning on doing this for any standoff now.
That's what I suspected, and that's been confirmed. Katie says this is a new tactic. Somehow, Channel 8 didn't talk about a new tactic of home demolition.
Nope.
Hey, listen, it's perfect. You got a house you want to get rid of, right?
Yeah.
How many did they tear down in Detroit for no cause, except they're a blight? Supposedly they're a blight, even though they're people's home. This is the perfect gentrification tool.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely it is. I told Katie, I said, this is right out of RoboCop 3.
It is.
I don't know if you've seen it.
Oh, yeah. I saw one.
Yeah. Well, in the third one, they have what they call relocators, OCP. The owners of the Detroit Police Department now have a separate division called the relocators. Oh, and by the way, they sell action figures of the relocators.
Why not?
Yeah. And they are going through the Cadillac Heights neighborhood, and they're going to gentrify it.
They're
kicking all these people out, tearing down. There's a couple living in their home or living in their apartment. Next thing you know, here comes the big wrecking ball coming right through their wall.
So a week from now, it'll just be completely a vacant lot, which a developer will come and build 3-unit apartment house.
That'll be next. Let me read the quote from Chief Coakley. Quote, "Everything done by law enforcement was to avoid the outcome of further injury or loss of life. The top priority of law enforcement is to keep the community safe. We are always concerned about the people around us. My second priority is the safety of my team and all officers on the scene. I will not send my officers into a hail of gunfire. While it's unfortunate that damage was caused to this home, we prioritize lives before property. Property is always secondary to human life," end of quote. Yep. Once again, bullshit.
It all depends on the definition.
Yes.
Is. When they say community, which community are they talking about? Anybody will know there's fractions in the community, right? There's the gay community. There's the corporate community. There's the black community, right? Which community are you referring to? It's not the total composite community that you care about. Never has been.
Let me give you the last paragraph here. Coakley said the homeowner will receive a fair market value payment for the property. The family that was living in the house has been moved into another home by a landlord that saw this on Channel 8 and said, "I need to help these people." Coakley said that the family would also receive fair market value for their destroyed belongings. Mayor David Anderson said the city was committing to helping the family move into new housing and ensuring they have everything they need.
Yeah,
doesn't make up for it. You can give them hell. I hope they get an attorney. I hope they get Figer, because Figer will grab the city of Kalamazoo by the throat and start choking them until money starts squeezing out of their rear end.
Then he can drive right down the highway towards Benton Harbor when he's done with that. But here's the thing. I'm sitting in a home that I once lived in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at pictures through the door there of my family. I'm looking at pictures that go back 40, 50 years.
Yeah.
What's a fair market value for those, Darren? Who's going to set the fair market value? There's keepsakes that my dad gave me, mm-hmm. you know, that if it's your first baseball, it's probably worth, what, $3 or $4? So is that a fair price?
Yeah.
You know, an old used baseball?
Exactly.
Fair price.
Who determines the fair price? That's what I'd like to know.
First of all, you have neighbors you've been around for years, right? People mm-hmm. you love. I that's ideally the situation. Some of these communities are that tight. Mm-hmm. What value is that?
Yeah. Here's what I'm going to do, and I want everybody that's listening in the state of Michigan to do this for me. I never ask for anything. Rarely. This is what I want. I want every single person in the state of Michigan that is hearing my voice right now, I want you to call every single legislator in the state of Michigan. This practice needs to be outlawed now. Now. Not next week. Now.
When you hear of the defund movement, which many supposed progressives spit out like sour candy, right? I mean, there's no way that they think. You heard, we just talked last week about Jim Carville's enmity towards progressives that talk about defund.
Jim Carville. Carville, yeah.
You look at the, what's the word? The absolute enhancement of weapons that they're getting from the military and the weapons and the spray. The protesters now in large groups can be knocked down with a ray of heat. They have weapon-grade stuff that goes beyond science fiction, and it mounts and it grows. Here's an example of it. But defund the police doesn't make any sense to you.
Yeah. It does make sense to our good friend Jeff Smith. I've got this.
I may disagree with the terminology a bit, but I'll tell you what, I don't disagree with the intent.
No, I agree with what Katie said. It's not defund the police. It's destroy the police. Get rid of them. You need to get rid of them. Because all they are tools for the rich.
Tools for the rich, and they're a threat to...
And a threat to everybody else.
Voice.
You know, and my mom hasn't figured it out yet. Oh, you might need one. No, I don't. God. Here's what we do need. Jeff Smith of Grid wrote this on November 10th. By the way, you can see his article in full at grid.org, G-R-I-I-D.org. That's the Grand Rapids Institute for Information Democracy. He wrote that on Tuesday he sent a letter to Grand Rapids City Manager Mark Washington, Mayor Rosalind Bliss, and the six city commissioners. He has the contents of the letter in the article here. He is requesting, in the interest of transparency, he said the public has the right to know the different types of equipment and weaponry that the Grand Rapids Police Department has access to, along with the quantity of each. The public has a right to know this because, one, the public pays for it all, equipment and weaponry, and two, the public should be aware of the kinds of equipment or weaponry that may be used against them. And he has several examples here. This is actually a graphic from the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, because they have more transparency than we do here in the States. They have a Remington 870 police, a Mossberg 590 A1, they have knives, pepper spray, Smith & Wesson revolver, Sig Sauer, or Glock, probably a Glock 9, patrol carbines, Taser International M26, collapsible and expandable batons, and bulletproof vests. Meanwhile, Grand Rapids has armored tanks. Mm-hmm. Kalamazoo does. We saw him in action tearing down a house.
Yeah.
And yet we've got people who are supposedly on the left that are just supporting the police.
Well,
perfect example, and Jeff talks about it. He posted on his Facebook page. I'll just read what he said. Ed Kettle, who we both know. Ed Kettle used to host a show on the station that I used to run in Kentwood. I've known Ed Kettle for quite a while. I was actually the one, and I'll just say it right here. I'll tell you what I posted on there. The worst thing that I ever did when I was running that station was to give Ed, yeah. Nathan, and Malky Kettle airtime.
Yeah, I'd agree.
The second worst was the quote-unquote union show that was a bunch of centrists. Second dumbest thing I ever did. You can't blame me for Tyrone. Bob forced that on me. I had nothing to do with that.
Well,
let me continue here. Yeah. Ed Kettle has been involved in the GR electoral political scene for decades. He sits on the Public Safety Committee. Kettle started the Facebook page and website called Friends of GR Cops. He also does public relations work for the Grand Rapids Police Officers Association. In 2019, here's what he wrote. Quote, police enforce the laws. The vast majority of people of every background just naturally obey those laws. But the bottom line is, if a person is told by a police officer to get out of the car, they should get out of the car. Resisting arrest is against the law. There is no constitutional protection for resisting. Shut up, don't resist, and ask for an attorney. At the Grand Rapids City Commission meeting on November 9th, Ed Kettle referred to Justice for Black Lives Matter activists as kids who are rude and engage in vile behavior. He repeatedly defended the GRPD. When he was done, he went to the back of the room to talk to Police Chief Eric Payne, who thankfully is retiring. I'm just worried about who they're going to get to replace him.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you really want proof of how I feel, I can go back into the archives of Southpaws in 2016 when Nate Kettle called into the show and started in about me not wanting to vote for Hillary to the point that he kept talking over the top of me and he wouldn't shut up, and I finally had to drop the call. That day, I lost every piece of respect I have for Nathan Kettle.
Yeah, you know, the neoliberal politics is an old story with us. I want to look at it in a different perspective. We have a group of black ministers that walk out with police now.
Yeah.
Give them credibility. We had another so-called colleague of ours in the broadcast arena here in Grand Rapids, Michigan, sponsors a softball game every year with the community. There we go, with the community and the policemen. You know, so that's nine policemen and nine community members playing softball, laughing it up and having a pizza afterwards. Good, good community relations. We can torment 15-year-olds with guns and threaten them on the street, and we talked about that. We can hide a drunk city official with police shenanigans. Our show went through all that. But here's Ed Kettle. Here's Ed Kettle in the same genre as all this phony goodwill kumbaya stories to pat the department on the back to somehow make them palatable to the community. And if you do that, you are considered relevant. They'll make sure you're relevant, Darren.
Mm-hmm.
They'll give you a position. Isn't this the guy that got mixed in with a marijuana issue, had a candidate? You remember way back he supported
Roy Schmidt. Is
yeah.
that who you're talking about?
Yeah.
Roy Schmidt, the first week that we aired this show, the same Roy Schmidt, who was a state representative, who decided to switch from the Democratic Party to the Republican Party because he thought he could get more done as a Republican, then recruited a fake candidate who was a friend of his nephew's to quote-unquote run as a Democrat. There's video of Roy Schmidt meeting this kid at the Secretary of State's office to file the paperwork to run. There's video of it.
And wasn't Kettle a friend of his?
Probably. Wouldn't surprise me. Birds of a feather flock together, right?
When I was teaching at Union High School, I had a debate. Packed the whole auditorium because of the election. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Schmidt and these guys all showed up.
Yeah.
And we let them try and speak and see their perspective. I think the kids could see they're phonies.
I hope so.
And then I called the boiling pots when when Kettle had the show, and his son would just pontificate into the ozones with patting themselves on the back for being such community cornerstones.
Yeah.
Anyway. Let's move on before we get any cigarettes.
Let's go on. I might need the mustard and water to kind of get me going here, but let's go on to our next segment.
Stop. Hammer time.
Oh, yeah, it's hammer time. It is time to drop the hammer on the douchebag of the week. All we have to do is look to Congress for this one. He's a past winner. winner of Douchebag of the Week, Representative Paul Gosar, QAnon of Arizona. Well, Republican, but he's actually one of these Q morons. Posted an anime video depicting him murdering Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Democrat of New York. I'll read what I wrote on our official page. This is the action of a psychopath. I'll say it again. All Republicans are bloodthirsty, violent sons of bitches. Every single goddamn last one of them. You can quote me on it. Starting with Gosar, starting with Boebert, starting with Marjorie Taylor Greene. They're all violent. All of them. Your neighbor that flies the little blacked out American flag? Yeah, right there. Gosar needs to not only be kicked out of Congress. By the way, the Democrats are filing a resolution to censure him. But he needs to be removed from Congress. He is a danger. He is creating a hostile work environment. Kick him out of Congress, then prosecute his ass and send him to prison.
Exactly. Can anybody, I'm going to say this so calmly, can anybody see the heightened amount of violence and demonstrated threats that exist in our political arena today? If you go back 10 years ago, this would have been like a rock from Mars falling in Congress. It'd be so alien. This kind of violence, this kind of intimidation, what we're seeing is unprecedented. But people have a little window of remembrance. It's the United States of amnesia. They can't see how far off the rails this is. And, you know, you put your finger in the Colorado River, you have to think, this water came all the way from a lake in Minnesota. You put your finger on this violent depiction of murdering somebody, and you know where that came from? You want to follow that stream going back to making fun of a crippled people? I'm not the brightest bulb in the universe. I can see the connection. I can realize the stream that got us to a point where you're threatening fellow Congress people. Can anybody else? Because if you don't, it's going to get worse. They're tolerating acts of violence now. They're glorifying a guy that shot three people at point-blank range, and a man that kneeled on the sideline to protest violence with the police is considered a traitor, and this little turd snapper is considered a hero.
Yeah.
How do we get here? You got to realize how bad it's getting and how it's increasing.
It's gotten that bad because nobody follows the paradox of tolerance. Oh, they're just crazy. We'll just let them talk. They're entitled to their opinion. No, they're not!
Gosar, Christ. Rittenhouse are fruit a la carte from Donald J. Trump.
Yep. All goes back.
That's the headwaters of the water down here in Colorado. That's where it's at.
It goes right back to Trump. I agree with you 100%. It really does. And if you don't believe it, then you might need to look in the mirror and ask yourself, why don't you see this?
And you can say all you want. Well, let's move on. You can't move on. He's a growing influence. He's growing more and more nuts every day.
Cancer.
Violent nuts.
He's a cancer is what he is. He is a cancer. He is a cancer on this country. And if you can't see it, then you're either blind or stupid. It's one or the other. Or you're a sympathizer. You might be a closet QAnon. Cuckoo.
Well, let's just stop on QAnon a second. Anybody who's blind to Trump's racism is equally blind. Anybody who entertains anything valid within QAnon, there's a buzzer.
Yeah.
Disqualified.
Yeah. Oh, God. And by the way, Paul Gosar, his own family members appeared on a political television ad, all of his siblings, and said, don't vote for our brother.
Listen to him.
That's a ringing endorsement.
You should have listened to
not
Trump's sister.
Not of him, but against him. Yeah, marry Trump. My uncle's a moron.
One of the demagogues in Ghostbusters, remember? They said, Gosar, it's Gosar. Not really, I'm sure of it. I'll have to get that out.
Gosar, it's douchebag. Douchebag.
Don't be a douchebag.
That's right. Hey, Paul. You want to try that with somebody? Pick on somebody your own size, twerp.
A bully doesn't pick on anybody their own size. Could we make a brief description of a bully?
Yeah, let's do so.
First of all, one of the traits is that they do pick on people that are not their equivalent, right?
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, they do it all their life.
Yeah.
Thirdly, help me out, they're not generous.
No.
You cannot be self-serving and be generous at the same time. And cowards are self-serving. This guy did this because it served his purpose.
And they're narcissists.
They're usually a narcissist. Yeah, right.
Have zero empathy.
And the friends they have are friends because they are seeking the same power that the bully is seeking.
Absolutely.
A la carte. Again, Donald Trump, vintage Donald Trump, Donald J. Trump. What is the reward that he gives people so that they are loyal to him? You want to know what it is? It's the same power he craves.
Yep, and absolutely. Absolutely.
You want to have druggies? Addict them.
Yep. Well, we are starting to get real low on time here, so I want to get to a couple of stories that we have on our official Facebook page. Go to facebook.com/Southpaws Radio Show to find these stories. We have one out of Rockland, California. A California high school is investigating after a screenshot surfaced of a controversial question that parents say was included in a history quiz. Here's the question. Identify a group of complete idiots. A, the KKK. B, all of Florida. C, Fox Propaganda Channel. D, Texans. I would answer E, all of the above. One story that I don't know why it's a story is Michigan Attorney General Dana Nessel has had to apologize because she had two Bloody Marys before the Michigan-Michigan State game on an empty stomach and apparently was incapacitated to the point that she had to be wheeled out on a wheelchair out of the stadium. You know what? If I had to deal with QAnon and Republican idiots all day like she does, I would day drink. Give Dana a break, please. Good Lord. We also have a story from the Associated Press. A high school runner was in the cross-country championship for Division II for the state of Michigan. When he crossed the finish line, he said, holy shit, and apparently said it loud enough that you could hear it 50 yards away. Well, the state disqualified him. Disqualified his second place finish for uttering a profanity. I hope this kid sues because he will win. You cannot limit speech at the school gates. You can't do it. It's illegal. It's very illegal. And one final story that I want to get to and just mention real quick. Speaking of bullies, a female high school goalie in Pennsylvania was heckled. I call it bullied. And now she's being rallied around. She is a absolute sweetheart. We need to get her on the show if we can find her. Folks, that music means we are out of time. We'll be back next week. I'm Darren Gibson.
I am Jack Prince.
For Katy Steele, please support independent media and the First Amendment.
The stations that carry Southpaws do not necessarily share the opinions expressed on the show. Southpaws is protected by the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution and is copyrighted by Big D Entertainment, all rights reserved.